Austin, and I'm going to be talking about variable transformations. So, first I want to talk about skewness. So if it's skewed left, that means the distribution of the variable, there's a lot of small outliers, and the mean is less than the median, and so they call it left skew because the mean is to the left of the median in the distribution. And right skew, the mean is to the right of the median in the distribution. You can also see it's called positive skew because there's a lot of positive outliers or large outliers. And then normal distribution would be that bell curve shape up there, and that's what we want our distribution to look like. That's what the assumptions for like linear regression, things like that, state that you need. And so to take care of transformations of variables that have skew, you can do use Tukey's ladder of power, and you can see you have to go up or down the ladder. You start in the middle, which is y1, and if the distribution is skew right, you move down the ladder, and those movements are first the square root of the variable, next to the log of the variable, and then the inverse square root, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And if you're skewed the other way, so say you have a lot of small outliers, you move up the ladder, and those steps are y squared, y cubed, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that would be, and then you just, after you change it, you check to see if you're normal or approximately normal. And if not, you know, you need to move either up or down in a lot of this based on what the distribution looks like. So the reason we need to change our variables is so we can get to constant variance. So here's a picture of non-constant variance. These are the types of issues we see when we don't transform our variables when we should. And then we know we have to transform our variables until our residual plots look something like this, where we see constant variance. And that, because that's another one of the assumptions that linear regression that makes linear regression necessary. So curvature is another thing that where you need to take care of transformations. You can't have a curved distribution of x and y. You can see these, there's curved up, curved down, there's some curvature in each of these. So this would indicate that we need to transform either the x or the y in order to get a linear relationship to fit a linear model, because we need a linear relationship. That's one of the assumptions for linear regression. And to take care of that, we use Bulging's rule. So if the distribution looks something like that, curved kind of downward, you either would take x squared or x cubed, or you take y and you square it or cube it, and then the same for each one of these. So if it's bent down like that in the top right corner, you'd either take y cubed or y squared or the log of x and the square root of x. This bottom one, where you on the right, where you have, or I guess your guys' left, where you're curved downward like that, you'd either do log x square root of x, and or log y square root of y. And then this last one here, where you're curved upwards on the bottom, it's either the square root of y log y or x squared x cubed, and then generally those will take care of it. But if it doesn't, and you see curvature or a different type of curvature, you can just apply Bulging's rule again, and then until you have something that's approximately linear. So a test for curvature, Tukey's test for curvature. This is an example from DEPA's handout on power transformations. Here's the original model they fit is over there. And you can see there's a little bit of curvature from that plot. To test for curvature, you then would save the predicted value of that model, and then you'd fit that in a different regression model. And then you can see right here the predictive volume squared for this example, which is the volume would be the response in this example. You can see the predicted volume squared, there's a very significant p-value of less than 0.001, which would indicate that there's curvature in this example, and you can see that from the top right plot. It's very clear that there's curvature. I mean, it's usually pretty easy to eyeball if there's curvature or not, but this is just one way to test to make sure that there's the existence of curvature and that you probably need to transform something. So one way to automate transformations is using the Box-Cox method. This, your machine will do this for you. The equation for that is y to the lambda transformation, and for lambda not equal 0, the transformation is y to lambda minus 1 over lambda. For y equaling 0, it's just a log transformation. And so you run the Box-Cox method, and then it gives you like a set of range to optimize lambda for the most normality of that variable. There are issues though if you have a lot of very, very large outliers. Sometimes the Box-Cox method, it's more like skewed from those huge outliers. So you do have to make sure that it's safe to use this method. But when you do, you get something like this, and then the optimal lambdas are somewhere in between this intersection here, where it looks like at about 0.1 to around 0.5 would be like the optimal lambda for transformation here. I might just use log transformation because it's pretty easy to do, and it's close to the values of the optimal lambda. So in conclusion, you need to use variable transformations to normalize data, and there's a few different methods for doing that, like bulging rule, Tukey's ladder of powers, and the Box-Cox method. So in order to get the assumptions you need for linear regression, you need to transform variables when there exists non-normality. Where's the